political cases. A new Supreme Court session begins. How it could shape abortion laws across the country. Avoiding economic disaster. President Joe Biden appeals to lawmakers to raise the country's debt ceiling. Democratic stalemate. Progressives and moderates fail to reach a deal in Congress. Where they go from here? And defending the unborn. Protesters in Mexico call for a nationwide system that protects life. On EWTN News Nightly for Monday, October 4th, 2021. Thank you so much for being with us tonight on this Feast of St. Francis of Assisi. I'm Tracy Sable. In Washington, the Supreme Court is back to the bench, and this term, the justices will consider major cases on issues including abortion, gun rights, and religious freedom. Today is the first time since the start of the coronavirus pandemic that the justices have heard oral arguments in person at the Supreme Court. Associate Justice Brett Kavanaugh called into the proceedings as he recovers from COVID-19. And joining us now to talk more about this is Amy Howe, co-founder of SCOTUS Blog. Amy, welcome back. So good to see you. Let's talk about the cases on the docket, starting with Dobbs versus Jackson Women's Health Organization, which really could potentially have an impact on Roe versus Wade.
That's right. This is a challenge to a Mississippi law that bans almost all abortions after the 15th week of pregnancy. And the lower court struck down the law, said it was unconstitutional. So the state came to the Supreme Court last year, asked the justices to weigh in, and the justices agreed to do so earlier this year. They'll hear oral argument in December with a decision likely sometime next year. When the state came to the Supreme Court, it was just asking them to weigh in on the law. But in its brief on the merits, it actually asked them to overrule Roe versus Wade and Planned Parenthood versus Casey, the landmark decisions establishing the constitutional right to an abortion. So depending on exactly how the court rules, obviously the impact of this case could be really, really decisive.
Yeah, and on the religious freedom front, the court is considering whether the state of Maine can exclude religious schools from a state tuition voucher program. Tell us more about that, and how do you see this playing out?
So this is a really interesting case. The state of Maine, because it's kind of rural, has an unusual system in which school districts can opt, instead of providing high school educations, can opt to send a school district can send its students to another public high school and pay the public high school back, to send its students to a private high school and pay that private school, or it can provide tuition vouchers for parents to send their children to the private school of their choice. But the school districts say they won't spend money to send children to private schools that provide religious instruction. And so the Supreme Court in 2020 said that if states don't have to provide public funding for private schools. If they do, the Supreme Court said in that case, which is a case called Espinoza versus Montana Department of Revenue, if they do, they can't discriminate against schools just because they're religious. And so this is a question of, can states discriminate against schools, can distinguish between schools because they provide religious instruction? And it's something that the Supreme Court has sort of tiptoed around for several years now, but the conservative majority is now going to take up this case and decide it.
Yeah, and Amy, there's another case I quickly want to talk about. And this one is revolving around death row inmates' access to ministers ahead of their execution. Talk to us about why this case is so significant.
Yeah, so this is a case, there was an execution scheduled in Texas a couple of weeks ago, and the inmate came to the Supreme Court and said, I want to have my spiritual advisor in the room with me, not only in the room with me, this is an issue that had been litigated a couple of times on an emergency basis at the Supreme Court, not just in the room with me, but I want him to be able to lay his hands on me and to pray out loud while I'm being executed. And the Supreme Court actually granted his request to put his execution on hold, and it's going to hear oral arguments in the case. It fast-tracked his appeal. It's going to hear oral arguments in the case in early November and decide the case. The state has cited security concerns as the reason not to, to allow this. But the Supreme Court is obviously very interested in this issue. And the, some of your viewers may have seen references to the what's sometimes called the shadow docket, these cases that come to the court on an emergency basis. And this is a case in which a case came to the Supreme Court on the shadow docket, and the Supreme Court said, we're actually going to go ahead and hold oral argument and decide it on the merit.
Hey, Amy, we have about a minute left here, but something I quickly also want to talk about is progressives, as you know, have been calling to increase the number of justices. Do you think President Joe Biden is likely to pursue packing the court?
So this is, you know, I think he's likely waiting to see the recommendations of the Supreme Court Commission. I testified before the commission, although not on the issue of the number of justices. I testified as a reporter on issues of transparency. You know, I think there's a question of what the president is likely to want to do and the question of what the president politically is likely to be able to do. And you know, I don't have views as a reporter on what the president should do, but certainly I think in this era of divided government, I think it's, you know, you see the issues that are going on right now in Congress with the budget, and it's just, I think, kind of hard to imagine a majority that is going to vote to expand the court or to adjust the term limits for justices right now.
Well, Amy, thank you so much for your time. Always great to get your analysis. Amy Howe, co-founder of SCOTUS Blog. Thank you again.
Thank you.
In the meantime, as Catholics mark the beginning of Respect Life Month, abortion supporters organized several hundred protest marches, including one at the Supreme Court this past weekend in Texas. A federal judge is expected to rule whether the state's heartbeat law can remain in force. With his controversial spending agenda currently on hold, President Joe Biden goes before cameras demanding the nation's debt ceiling be raised. Republicans have told Democrats to do that themselves or risk what the Treasury Secretary has warned could be a financial catastrophe. White House correspondent Owen Jensen begins our team coverage tonight. Owen?
Tracy, good evening to you. In his speech today, President Biden said the U.S. always pays its bills, has never defaulted, and that the full faith and credit is rock solid. But he was quick to pin blame.
President Joe Biden comes out swinging by slamming Republicans.
What they're doing today is so reckless and dangerous, in my view.
And he emphasized,
raising the debt limit is about paying off our old debts. It has nothing to do with any new spending being considered. It has nothing to do with my plan for infrastructure or building back better. Zero.
The president warned even before the default date arrives later this month, Americans could see retirement accounts take a hit and face higher mortgage and car payments.
Defaulting on the debt would lead to a self-inflicted wound that takes our economy over a cliff and risks jobs and retirement savings, Social Security benefits.
But Republican Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell whipped off a letter to the president saying that Americans are already feeling painful inflation, and warned that Democrats are preparing another staggering tax and spending spree.
He adds bipartisanship is not a light switch that Speaker Pelosi and Leader Schumer may flip on to borrow money and flip off to spend it. Republicans' position is simple. We have no list of demands. For 2.5 months, we have simply warned that since your party wishes to govern alone, it must handle the debt limit alone as well. The Heritage Foundation, also critical of the White House, writing in part, the Democrats control both chambers of Congress and could increase the debt limit by a specific dollar amount themselves. How? By using the same partisan process they are using to advance their massive tax and spending package.
Now, the default date is still 2 weeks away, October 18th. Meanwhile, President Biden heads to Michigan tomorrow to continue to sell his massive and very controversial economic proposals, which of course remain up in the air as well. At the White House, Owen Jensen, EWTN News Nightly.
On Capitol Hill, the fighting continues among Democrats over the size and scope of two infrastructure bills. Progressives and moderates are at odds over the final amount in the larger multi-trillion dollar human infrastructure bill. That has caused a stalemate on the smaller road and bridges infrastructure package. Capitol Hill correspondent Eric Rosales reports.
What this is a tale of two bills. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi doesn't have the votes to pass them, so she hit the pause button. She wrote out over the weekend a Dear Colleague letter advising members that she set a new date of October 31st to pass the bipartisan $1.2 trillion infrastructure bill. In the letter, the speaker said that, quote, more time was needed, and, quote, we must pass BIF well before then. The sooner the better to get the jobs out there.
Democrats, though, are stressing to America they're united.
Failure isn't an option, and there's a lot more unity in this room than you might imagine. The issue isn't in the Democratic House caucus. The issue is in the Senate.
In the Senate, Democratic progressives are rejecting Senator Joe Manchin's demands for a much lower price tag for the human infrastructure bill. His top line is $1.5 trillion, less than half of what the White House is pushing for. But some congressional Democrats say things need to be settled among themselves, not necessarily with President Biden's help.
A lot of this negotiation has to do with our business here in the House and the Senate.
Republicans tell me they don't have an issue passing a true infrastructure bill that deals specifically with roads and bridges.
There's not Republican roads, Democrat roads. It's not a partisan issue. But what is a partisan issue becomes $500 billion in new debt that's attached to the infrastructure bill that's over in the House at this point.
Senator James Lankford says we have more than $29 trillion in new debt right now, and we must address it.
We're seeing inflation rise around the country. People feel it with gasoline prices and bread prices and lumber and housing and everything else. People feel the inflation. That's going to continue to accelerate if we don't get a hold of our fiscal future.
Lawmakers have another important task on the horizon, one that will likely need bipartisan help, raising the nation's debt ceiling by October 18th.
Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer hopes to have a vote by the end of this week, or he could hold members in session throughout the weekend. At the Capitol, Eric Rosales, EWTN News Nightly.
Coming up, World Meeting of Families. Vatican organizers reveal new details about the upcoming event. And the Holy Father offers a gut check. What leads to true greatness? The German Catholic Church's synodal way will be extended to 2023. CNA Deutsch reports that the assembly ended abruptly on Saturday. There was one vote in favor of endorsing same-sex blessings. Another vote invited debate on whether the priesthood is necessary. For more on this story, including background on the synodal way, visit our partners at CatholicNewsAgency.com. Francis, bishops will receive findings of an independent investigation tomorrow which documents sexual abuse in the church since the 1950s. A commission has collected several thousand victim testimonies since 2019. The report is expected to estimate some 3,000 abusers were active in France through the 1980s. While thousands of pro-lifers marched in nearly 90 Mexican cities yesterday, the chant of Yes to Life was heard at the largest gathering in Mexico City. Many participants wore the color blue to symbolize pro-life. They were protesting a recent Mexican Supreme Court decision that decriminalized abortion. Mexico's pro-life Catholics say they support women and pre-born children. A Vatican trial resumes tomorrow, probing a failed London real estate venture. Cardinal Angelo Becciu is one of 10 defendants charged with potentially fraudulent transactions that lost hundreds of millions of dollars. Defense attorneys claim prosecutors failed to disclose key evidence in that case. Pope Francis has made two new charitable donations for victims of natural disasters. A $75,000 contribution is for flood-swept South Sudan. Another $58,000 goes to wildfire-afflicted areas in Greece. Pope Francis reminds the faithful that self-sufficiency does not lead to greatness.
Nella vita, riconoscersi piccoli è un punto di partenza.
At a Sunday address to pilgrims at the Vatican, the Holy Father says true greatness will come when we recognize our own weakness and place our hope in the Lord rather than ourselves. The Holy Father also asked the faithful to, quote, serve the little ones and recognize the smallness in ourselves. The Vatican is preparing for the World Meeting of Families next summer amid the continuing coronavirus pandemic. Organizers say the event will include both in-person and online events. In-person attendance will be limited to 2,000 delegates. The World Meeting of Families takes place in June 2022 in Rome. However, the preparations have been ongoing for more than 3 years. Joining us now from Rome is Hannah Brockhaus, senior Rome correspondent of Catholic News Agency. Hannah, good to see you again. Can you tell us more about the World Meeting of Families and how often it takes place and what work does it focus on?
Well, Tracy, the World Meeting of Families will take place in the Diocese of Rome at the Vatican next year in June 2022. It's actually taking place after 4 years. The last meeting was in Dublin, Ireland in 2018, but it was delayed by 1 year because of the coronavirus pandemic. Usually takes place every 3 years. And of course, it focuses on families, their needs, their testimony. There will be conferences and things of that sort. And in general, it's just a gathering place for Catholic families to meet from all over the world.
And for the World Meeting of Families next year, what do you think will be the most important events? And also, how is it being influenced about the coronavirus pandemic? You touched on that.
Right. Well, of course, daily Mass and Eucharistic adoration will be very important. There will be other talks. The first day will include an encounter with Pope Francis. And then on the 25th of June, there will also be a special Mass with Pope Francis in St. Peter's Square that will include families from the Diocese of Rome. And then these 2,000 delegates from around the world. This is kind of the biggest impact of the pandemic, is they've decided to limit the event to around 2,000 people just due to travel restrictions still being in place, also obviously wanting to control crowd size. So these people will be representatives of the various dioceses around the world, different family associations, things of that sort.
Yeah, and speaking of big events, Hannah, I understand the dates for the next World Youth Day were actually made official today. What more can you tell us about that?
That's right. So in 2023, it will take place the World Youth Day, which is obviously a very exciting event. And they announced today that the dates will be August 1st through 6th in Portugal. As we know, it's going to be in Lisbona. So that event, now we know when the dates will be and people can start planning for that event in the summer of 2023.
Very exciting. Thank you so much, Hannah. Hannah Brockhaus, senior Rome correspondent of Catholic News Agency. Thank you again.
You're welcome.
Up next, lasting legacy. Father Dave Pivonka reminds us of the importance of St. Francis of Assisi on his feast day. Now today, the church celebrates the feast day of St. Francis of Assisi, the founder of the Franciscan Order. And joining us now to share more of the story of St. Francis is Father Dave Pivonka, president of the Franciscan University of Steubenville. Good to see you again, Father Dave. Can you tell us a little bit more about St. Francis of Assisi and why he's so often depicted with animals?
Well, first off, thank you for letting me be with you. We say around here at Franciscan University, it's like Christmas morning. And I think, honestly, there's lots of stories about Francis as it relates to animals. But one of the things that he was able to recognize and appreciate was that the world is graced, is that the Lord, all things bring glory, and all creation brings glory to the Lord. And that's important for us to recognize, that it's, animals, a tree, all of this. It's not that God, blesses those and reveals himself and shows himself. So that's a part of it, that all things, the world is graced because God's created it. Now, there's some wonderful, beautiful stories about Francis and animals. Probably the most famous is the wolf of Gubbio that was kind of terrorizing the community. And Francis engaged him in essence as if the community would care for him, for this wolf, then he would actually protect the community. So there's all kinds of different stories and legends about that are really beautiful. But I always joke that a danger is that we make Francis just about a bird bath. And while, yes, he's in many bird baths, he's so much more than that. And we just always like to recognize the sanctity, the holiness that many have called Francis the mirror of Christ. So the stories are beautiful, they're heartwarming, but it's also important that we keep in mind the larger picture that is Francis of Assisi.
Absolutely. And also, can you tell us about St. Francis and the significance of the San Damiano cross?
Yeah, it's one of the more beautiful and I think profound stories, particularly for us at Franciscan University, because in many ways it drives us and gives us vision and wisdom. Francis is, he's in the process of conversion. And if we read the commentators about Francis, it's important that we understand that, that Francis saw conversion as a process. It's not a singular event, but we continue to go. The word that we speak of is this idea of metanoia. So Francis is in this process of conversion, process of metanoia. And he's praying in front of the San Damiano cross, which is the Franciscan cross. And he heard the Lord speak to him from that cross. Francis, rebuild my church, which you can see is in ruins. And Francis, being eminently practical, he just began to literally rebuild a church, the San Damiano, the Porciuncola, various churches in the area. And then he realized that it's something more than that, that it wasn't just these old churches, these old chapels that need to be fixed or renovated, but it's the church. And it's interesting. That was almost 850 years ago. But some of the same struggles that the church was dealing with then are the same struggles that we're dealing with now. Lack of recognition of Jesus's presence in the Blessed Sacrament. You know, kind of a lackadaisical nature among the laity. Priests that were often in scandal. I would love to say that there was a time that the church was never struggling, but the reality is that she continues to struggle. So Francis heard the Lord rebuild the church, and we as Franciscans continue hear the Lord say that to us today.
And Father Dave, can you talk about how, you know, St. Francis is still relevant today? And also, are there maybe some little known facts about him that people are unaware of?
Yeah, I think one of the most beautiful things about St. Francis is that he's relevant in any time, is that it's not merely an event that took place 850 years ago, but he continues to speak to us today. So a couple of the things that I think are most beautiful and relevant to us are, and it's really a beautiful insight that Francis provided us, and that is the humility of God. For Francis, the greatest feast day is Christmas. It's not Easter. Often we would think the greatest solemnity would be Easter, but for Francis, he couldn't imagine a God that would take flesh, that Almighty God would empty himself and he would take on flesh. So that was remarkable. And then the next is that same God who would take on flesh, who would become human, would actually allow himself to be arrested, to be mocked, to be scourged, to be crucified. Again, Francis just couldn't imagine this, that God would allow himself to suffer and die for us. And then finally, that God who took on flesh, who allowed himself to be crucified, would come to us in the Eucharist. For Francis, this was just remarkable. And it continues to speak of the humility of God. And I think that's one of the things that the Lord would invite us to today, is to recognize that God wants to engage us. He wants to embrace us. He wants to come to us. And he does that in all kinds of ways, through creation that Francis would speak of, but also through the Eucharist and through the gift of the sacraments. We continue to reflect on this God who always wants to dwell with us. And Francis reminded us of that.
And Father Dave, before I let you go, can you tell us what you're doing today at the university in honor of today's feast day? And also understand you're going to be leading a pilgrimage in Italy. Talk to us about that, too.
Yeah, well, wonderful. Thank you. Yes, the university, again, it's kind of like Christmas Day. I'm looking out my windows, and we've got classes in the morning, but we take part of the afternoon, and the entire community gathers for a liturgy. And it's just always a great blessing. One of the blessings that we have at Franciscan University is we have so many young people that want to go to Mass. We have to have 5 Masses a day. But every now and then, we just stop and we do one large liturgy. And that'll be this afternoon, which will be just wonderful. Last night, we celebrated the Transitus of Francis, which is the memorial of the passing. Our chapel was packed. And it's just a very simple memorial, remembering Francis, but also being able to have his relics present and be able to spend some time in reflection on that. And then this evening, we're having a big celebration dinner, outdoor dinner, if the weather holds. It'd just be a great opportunity for everybody to celebrate. That's right. And in March, I will be taking, this is actually Franciscan University's 75th anniversary, which is December 10th. So we're going to have a special celebration. I'm taking pilgrims to Rome and Assisi to be able to remember Francis and just the deep impact that he's had just on Franciscan University, obviously, on myself, but on the church. I can't imagine a church without Francis, the number of hospitals and schools that are devoted to St. Francis. Yeah, so we want to be able to celebrate that.
Yeah, that's amazing. And Father Dave, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us today. We really appreciate it.
It's always my blessing. Thank you so much. And everybody have a great feast day.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. God bless.
Thank you.
And we thank you for watching tonight. For the entire EWTN News Nightly team, I'm Tracy Sable. Good night and God bless.